I am a mathematician, and I am the kind of mathematician who thinks about things like this. And when I look at this, I don't see a bunch of symbols. I see a fish pond. And in fact, when I look out at all of you, I see a fish pond. And this first row of people, we'll include you over there too. This first row of people, you are all fish in my fish pond. So raise your hands. Yes, you are fish. Now, what this tells me is that the next time I look around and look away, when I look back, the second row will all be fish as well. So second row, raise your hands. Yeah, over there too, yeah, you guys. You are all fish now too. All right, so we're doubling. We have two rows. We're going to have to add two more rows. So rows three and four, raise your hands. All right, you are fish now too. Double again. Rows five, six, seven, and eight, raise your hands. All right, you are all part of my fish pond. All right, raise your hand if you're a fish. Thank you. All right, that means the pond's about half full. So back half of the room, raise your hands. You are all fish in our next generation. All right, yes, thank you. So that's what I see when I look at that. And when I don't have a group of people in front of me willing to raise their hands and pretend to be fish, I think of it more like this. So I can see one fish, two fish, four fish, eight fish, 16 fish. And there's one problem that happens when I'm thinking about that equation and being fish, and that's that eventually I run out of space, but the equation keeps going, right? So I can come up with another equation, something a little different, something that looks like this. So my fish population will grow, and then it's just going to flatten out. It's going to reach the capacity of the fish pond and become flat. And there's a model that does this. It's called the Logistic Model. And it looks like this. So what this just says is my new population is twice my old population times 1 minus that old population. Another pretty useful way of thinking about this is the curve there. And if you just look at that bottom black curve, you can imagine that's just connecting the top fish in each column. So this says my fish column grows and flattens out. All right, I have to say, this equation is fascinating. It's a really interesting equation. But I'll tell you why, I promise. So the reason this is so interesting is it's very simple. Right? It's two multiplications and a subtraction. It's pretty simple. But it has the potential for deep complexity. So to see that, what we're going to do is we're going to add one more fish to our pond when we start. And that's going to give us that red curve that sits on top. It says, my fish population starts with more fish, but it still grows, hits capacity, and flattens out. Now, let's see what happens if instead of changing my starting number, I change that number 2 that's in the front. So you see that number 2 in the equation? I'm going to change that. I'm going to increase it up to around 4. And I get chaos. So again, this curve is just counting the number of fish in my pond. But now instead of nicely behaving, growing, and flattening out, it's all over the place. It looks incredibly erratic. One might say chaotic. And we can do that same experiment. We can start with one more fish than we did before. So this is starting with one fish. And that red line there, that's what happens when we start with two fish. And so if I start with just one more fish in my pond, look at what happens at the very end. With one fish, my pond ends up almost full. But with two fish, it ends up almost empty. Right? This is what's called the butterfly effect. And that term's been popularized in a lot of movies. The butterfly effect was described by a meteorologist, actually, Edward Lorenz. And what he said was that this model, mathematical model, of the atmosphere that he was looking at was so incredibly sensitive that something as small as a butterfly flapping its wings in South America could create this little puff of air that would move up and cause what would have otherwise been a clear day in Kansas to be a stormy day with tornadoes. Something that small could have a huge impact. Now, you may have had what I would call a personal butterfly effect in your life, some moment where a decision you made ended up having implications that were much larger than you would have expected. And according to process relational philosophy, this is because we are all deeply interconnected to one another. In fact, what that philosophy says is that every person, creature, object, every molecule in the entire universe comes together in each moment to create my reality and your reality, our shared reality. Right? That means that small decisions I make can have big implications, not just for me, but for people who I could never know, and in ways I could never know. So one example for this, to me, is the so-called Twitter revolutions. So when Twitter was created, the name, in part, was because of what the creators had seen as a definition of Twitter, which was chirping of birds and small bursts of inconsequential information. So these small bursts of inconsequential information were then used throughout the Middle East and North Africa to organize protests, which have led to toppling of regimes. It's a pretty small little flap of a butterfly's wings causing a pretty big tornado. Now, this connection between process relational philosophy and math, chaos theory, I did not come to that on my own. I came to that with a friend of mine, Christine Dinkins. She's a philosopher, and we taught a learning community together. A learning community is a pair of courses from different departments tied around a common theme and with the same students in each class. And our class combined math and philosophy, and the theme was, what is the nature of reality? The idea of doing this is what educators call interdisciplinary learning. We've actually heard that term earlier today. It's just the idea that we learn better when we learn from multiple perspectives. And I certainly saw my students have a much deeper, more personal connection to their learning because of seeing it from multiple perspectives. And by way of illustrating this, I've recorded one of my students who wrote a poem for our class. He's pictured there, Josh Holt.
Well, what is reality? Was it given to us, or do we make it our own? Thinking it into existence, cogito ergo sum. Was it Descartes or Plato who figured it all out? Who defined what existence was in being, but could never prove their doubt? Was it? Is it? The fractalizing universe that obstructs our three-dimensional world with never-ending space? Filled with chaos theory, similarity of self, and its own organizing grace. A type of grace that can't be predicted, but always repeats. My experience, which by the way is all the way down, combines from the past to make my present and future. With its continual feedback, I see those relationships that process my life and mine theirs. An endless branch of process relational philosophy that keeps this reality going. Yes, by that I mean people. Relationships are part of my reality. You and you and yes, even you, are like these constellations of galaxies that feed into each supercluster and each supercluster into our own universe. Whitehead defines it. The soul is the flow of accumulative current flow of experience. It's ever-changing. And so just as you are all ever-changing and not the same with each day added onto one another like 1 + 1 = 2 and so on, reality is. My reality is this. It's the time I make of on this earth to live a life pleasing and fruitful, one that feeds back into the lives and yet pays it forward to the future.
All right, you may not have caught that unless you're a mathematician, but that was a math poem. Talked about self-similarity, chaos theory, feedback. That was math. What's also cool is it was a philosophy poem. It was both together. Personally, I took away a lot from this course as well. In particular, it gave me a way of taking something I love on a scientific level, chaos theory, and making it into a more of a personal philosophy and seeing it in a philosophical way. So, and I couldn't have done that without my conversations with Christine and that class we taught together. So as we go into this break, my hope is for all of you to find someone who you don't know, someone who thinks differently than you, and engage them in conversation. You could add a fish to the pond, a flap of a butterfly's wings, tweet, and see how it changes the world. Thank you.